All right. What is going on with my Goalie GNs, man? I hope you guys are doing good at home. Whenever you guys watch this, man, I'm super excited. Football season is here, right? Chiefs versus the Lions on Thursday night. I'm so excited, man. I got hella players in that game. So hopefully we get a lot of yards, catches to Amon-Ra St. Brown and my boy Travis Kelce. That would be really cool. Now, I'll be dropping my week one predictions later on, showing you guys our matchups across the Silver League, Bronze League, and especially the Gold League, giving you guys my predictions for week one, as always, as we've been doing for a while with this league, man. So I'm excited to do that. So stay tuned for that. I'm also going to be dropping a vlog from this weekend, man. That was such a fun draft that we did with everybody in person. Shout out to Swag, my boy Esteban, who drafted 7th in the draft, for pulling up and surprising all of us, man.
First pick. Who you second with the first pick?
Jake
Moody.
Second, Jake baby?
What a weekend it was. It was legendary, so I'm excited to drop that vlog soon, man. So shout out to you guys. I'm excited to start these videos and keep it going, man. So this video in particular, we're going to be just talking about draft grades, all right? So me as the commish, looking at your guys' teams and basically offering you a draft grade. It could be anywhere from an F to an A, right? I'm not saying that anybody got an F, but something like that, right? And I really try to make sure I factored just how you guys' teams are. Where did you draft players? What does your bench look like? When did you draft a defense? Like, just little things like that. And basically factored all these things into determining this grade. Now, obviously, this is just my grade. It's going to be a little bit different from Yahoo. But that's why I wanted to give it to you guys, to give another perspective out here as well, too. And to give a chance to talk about our team. So, I think we can easily agree that Raw Squad, Mahomes Depot, and Watch 'em Weep are easily the worst team names in the league, all right, fellas? Y'all need to get creative, okay, and get in your bag, all right, because what the hell is going on with y'all's team names, okay? Anyway, all right, let's jump into this now, all right? So I'm going to just start from the first pick, and we'll go all the way to the 10th pick in order, and we can break this down from here. All right, so let's go ahead and start with El Jefe first. Now, El Jefe had the number one pick in the draft, was able to get into the Sleeper app. Shout out to El Jefe for being able to get in there and make sure he gets his picks in. Now, his team right here, I thought he did fantastic in the first three rounds. Heavy hitters on every single pick. Justin Jefferson, Devontae Adams fell to him at the end of the second round, which is really shocking. If Devontae Adams is going to have a great year, which a lot of people think he can, regardless of the quarterback situation, him landing him at that point in the second round, absolute great value for El Jefe there. And then goes back with Joe Mixon, which hurt me a little more personally. I feel like I got sniped right there. I was hoping that boy Mixon was going to fall to me in the third round right there, but he doesn't. El Jefe, great squad right there. He has his dual wide receiver hero. He gets his running back one that he's going to go with. Then he goes back to back, obviously, right? And he's going to go with Breece Hall as the backup now, or as the RB2. Now, that's where, for me, it gets a little bit more shaky with Breece Hall, because we don't know what the health situation looks like. We don't know Dalvin Cook's playing time, how that cut into it. But if Breece Hall is what we saw Breece Hall was last year as an RB2, that's fantastic. But for me, there's a lot of risk behind that pick. Justin Jefferson, or Justin Herbert at the fifth round, fantastic value right there. Gets him in the fifth round there, and I thought that was great that you were able to nab him there versus trying to reach for someone in the third or the fourth. He was able to get his running backs and his wide receivers while still getting the quarterback. So that was great right there. I don't know how I feel about J.K. Dobbins as a flex. We just know J.K. Dobbins has a lot of injury history. And I think for me personally, I'm like, bro, I don't know how I feel about guys that are injured. But at the same time, this is why it's fantasy football and you never know what can happen. And J.K. Dobbins is raw in his flex, then damn, that's going to pan out. But if he's hurt, then it's going to get a little shaky here. And this is where I'm going to kind of go down to this bench real quick, because you got Mike Evans. We don't know what his contract situation looks like. A.J. Dillon, is he ever going to win us a league? Only if Aaron Jones gets hurt could A.J. Dillon turn into like a top 20, like, you know, second round, first round type fantasy player. Otherwise, you know, he's really just that kind of like fill-in player every now and then for that situation over there. I don't know how I feel about Odell. Taking Niners defense 11th, you know, we haven't even paid Nick Bosa yet. So how is our defense going to look? Who knows? So a lot of value was passed on there. Tyler Boyd, obviously you're going to need those Bengals receivers to get hurt for him to show value. Damian Harris, who knows? And then Tank Dell is a big-time sleeper. Will he pan out for the Texans? I'm not sure. You know, obviously, you know, like, he as a player will probably pan out, but like, will he be a sustainable fantasy value player? I mean, they might be behind in a lot of games, so Who knows? That might be a deep sleeper right there. But with this team right here, man, I think Hefe did a good job hitting his team, his players early on with Joe Mixon, Davante Adams. But I'm not sure how I feel about the bench, especially the eighth round, Pat Freiermuth. I don't know how I feel about that pick, considering that Evan Ingram, I think, was taken right before. And if you guys look at the board, no one else needed a tight end. So we're taking Pat Freiermuth and we're passing up on a lot of value. But you guys will notice that's a theme that I'm going to kind of bring up in this draft just to see if, like, hey, now you know for your own strategy, would that be something that you want to do for the next time? But at the end of the day, if I knew it all, I'd be the champ every single year. So that's why we take these draft grades with just a grain of salt, whether it's Yahoo or myself. It is what it is. So with El Jefe, we're going to go ahead and give him a C plus. That's right, a C plus draft grade. Now, I'm sorry, El Jefe, we might disagree, but I just don't know how I feel about the flex, and I don't know how I feel about the bench. And if Breece Hall isn't Breece Hall, then it's going to be a lot of coming back from behind. But hey, we're going to give some tough grades today as we keep going. So let's go ahead and keep going, all right? Let's talk about Meese now. Okay, we got Jamar Clase. No, I'm just kidding. This dude really messed up the sticker, putting his first pick up there. I'm so weak. But Meese had the second pick in the draft. He has Jamar Chase with the first pick. That was a great pick. I probably would have did the same thing if I was at that same spot with Meese. So I love that. Nabs Tony Pollard and then gets Travis Etienne. Fantastic picks. Gets his elite first-round talent, whatever position that may be. This happens to be receiver. And then Nabs dual running back hero. Nice, man. He gets Burrow in the fourth. That one, I want to call it a reach. But at the same time, he's getting his guy. You never know. Jeff had Joe Burrow last year. So there is that slight chance that is Jeff going to have two picks? And is he going to take Joe Burrow? And Jeff does end up taking Justin Herbert. So at the same time, he's solidifying his stack right there. So at the same time, you can't really be mad if people want to call that a reach or not. I was one of those people. So I think it's still a great pick because he solidified his running backs and solidified his stack. While still getting Amari Cooper, how is Amari Cooper going to look this year? He probably might be actually really good the more I've been looking at it. But who knows, is Deshaun Watson going to be good? But if Amari Cooper pans out, this is a damn good lineup that he has, to be honest with you. Amari Cooper as a wide receiver too would be really nice. But I don't know how I feel about DJ Moore as a flex. Is he sustainable? Javonte Williams, a lot of red questions there as well too. With Samaje Perine there, his health, how is that going to work out? So can he be trusted? But the best thing is Meese doesn't necessarily need Javonte Williams, but we're just talking about the flex here. I also think he and El Jefe collectively reached on Evan Ingram. I don't think you guys needed to necessarily draft him as high as you did, but hey, you got to go get your guy, so to each his own. Jaxon Smith-Njigba, I'm not sure. And honestly, if you go through his bench, besides the Eagles' defense, it's a lot of like, is this guy going to boom out or not? And some of these guys are really injury prone, but Devon Achane might be one of the best picks that he has on there. Even though the guy had injury history, he's looking like he's the RB2 now in Miami, which is a prime spot to be in case Raheem Mostert gets injured. So with Meese's draft, we're going to go ahead and give Meese a C+. Yeah, that's right. Now, you guys might be thinking I'm being very harsh, but I really am, man. I don't know how I feel about these flexes, and I don't know how I feel about these benches, and I don't know how I feel about the tight end value. And that's something that was very similar between El Jefe and Meese's draft. All right, so let's keep it going. Now we're going to talk about 49ers Dilraj. This guy gets Austin Ekeler and Josh Jacobs. He goes for dual running back hero, okay? Then he gets Jalen Hurts as well, too, in the third round. Quarterbacks are flying, so he gets his quarterback. At that point, I think third round is a great spot to go ahead and get. If you're going to get Hurts, Mahomes, Allen, to me, that's pretty good value right there. Here's where it gets interesting. The guy has a lot of faith in DK Metcalf and Debo Samuel. Having both the NFC West wide receivers in that spot, it's going to be interesting for him as a fan and as a fantasy football player. He must have a lot of faith that these guys are going to go off. I don't know how I feel about Debo. I just, as a fantasy player, who knows what can happen there. But as a 49ers fan, that is dope to have on your team. He took Dallas Goedert in the sixth, which I thought is a bit of a reach. But it's kind of the same thing with Meese and Levy. Like, if you know that's your guy and you want your guy, then go get him, right? So if Goddard is going to be raw this year, which he looked raw last year, I think he was just hurt, then it's a good pick. But maybe Goddard is still there in the eighth round. I don't know. But that's something that we're going to factor into this draft grade as well, too. I don't know how I feel about DeAndre Swift as a flex option, but as an RB3, that's fantastic. He's in a prime situation over there. Michael Pittman, George Pickens, even Alan Lazard, Jameson Williams. The way I look at those positions is that's great depth for his receivers. One of those guys will probably pan out if it's George Pickens, if not Michael Pittman. And then we'll go from there. The running backs, Zeke and Mitchell. shoot in the dark, I feel like, or shot in the dark. Like, you're just hoping some of these guys are just going to get that opportunity and roll the game from there. So I don't know. The bench receivers are good, but the running backs are a little bit questionable from there. But I do think the elite picks that he made in the beginning of the draft, if DK and Debo are DK and Debo that we would think they are in fantasy, that is a damn good squad. But if Debo's kind of struggling again and DK's kind of getting his role taken away by JSN or even Tyler Lockett, I don't know how I feel about that one. But with that being said, 49ers Raj, your draft grade is going to be a B. That's right. I'm going to give you a B. I think you have a good squad. It just depends on if these guys will live up to their hype, and then we'll see what happens. But the depth on the bench for me is also a little concerning. Now let's go ahead and jump to pick number 4. Now we're going to talk about Justin Neal. All right. Now Justin Neal, Christian McCaffrey at the 4 spot. Fell to him at 4. Wonderful pick there. Big time reach on Mahomes. Let's call it out for what it is. 98%, 99% chance Patrick Mahomes is available in the 3rd round. And even if he's not, you're still able to nab. Like, I guess what I'm trying to say is, by picking him in the 2nd round, you are basically saying, I'm okay with passing on a Josh Jacobs, Tony Pollard, Joe Mixon, Devontae Adams, Etienne. You probably just knew, probably could have had McCaffrey with the Tony Pollard or with the Josh Jacobs and a Mahomes and still had the chance to go get your McLaurin or Hockenson or whatever. So in my opinion, this is one of the second biggest reach in this draft. We're going to call it as a title, whatever you guys say. The second biggest reach in this draft, no matter what you guys want to say. Patrick Mahomes in the 2nd, that is absolutely ridiculous in my eyes, considering the fact that he probably is going to be available to him again. Even if me, which I was going to draft Mahomes at the 3rd, in the 3rd round if he fell to me, was not going to fall to me anyway. So there was no chance that it was going to happen. So that's a theme that I want you guys to notice in these drafts is people drafting players that were probably still going to be there for another round or two. And that's something that we're going to factor into a lot of these picks. Darren Waller. So with that being said, though, he still has a fantastic squad, isn't just Neal, because he got Jalen Waddle, then he still managed to land Ramondre Stevenson in the 4th round. That is a steal, in my opinion. TJ Hockenson in the 5th round got him right at the perfect value as well, too. Not a fan of Terry McLaurin. He's getting, not getting older, but he's hurt. And his quarterback situation, we don't really know what that's going to look like. Here's where Justin Neal's team gets really interesting, though. Alvin Kamara as the RB3. Once Alvin Kamara comes back, whether he has him in the flex or as an RB2, that's going to really boost this roster and honestly help the fact that he does have Mahomes. Here's where it gets tricky, though, is because Kamara's not playing and because you took Mahomes in the 2nd round, you're going to be feeling that depth in the first 3 weeks. So will Justin Neal be in too much of a hole to come back out of it by the time Kamara gets back? Or will Justin Neal be good? We'll find out. But I think he did a good job drafting these receivers to help that fact. You got Tyler Lockett, Deontay Johnson. Not a fan of Treylon Burks. Zay Flowers is one of those, you know, good pick because you never know. He probably might have a breakout, you know, rookie campaign. And you got that guy on your bench. So that's a good pick. Samaje Perine, fantastic pick. Tank Bigsby, throw that out the window. This isn't a dynasty league. I don't know why that pick was there. But he did draft a good depth with receivers, and he doesn't necessarily need Kamara right away. So with that being said, just, you know, I actually really liked your draft, except for the reach on Mahomes, because you probably could have had him still. So I'm going to give you a B minus. If you have this draft where Mahomes is in the 3rd round, you're probably in the A range, if I'm being truthfully honest. But to each its own, that's just my opinion. Now we talk about my team, the 5th pick in the draft. Obviously, everyone likes their own team. So it is what it is, but I'll just spend a second just to talk about it for the sake of the video. So, nabbed tight end in the 1st round. Just wanted to solidify that. Got Amon-Ra. Jahmyr Gibbs was gaslighted by, like, Mauricio and everybody. Was like, oh, you reached on Gibbs, which maybe I did. Maybe I should have taken Aaron Jones, but actually I like the upside of Gibbs. I'm going for more of the ceiling. So, for me, I was comfortable taking him over Najee and even Aaron Jones, and those were the only two backs that were taken after that fact. Everyone told me that I should have taken Taylor. Well, Taylor fell to me in the 4th. But now, looking at the situation and considering Jonathan Taylor's on PUP, maybe I should have passed on Jonathan Taylor. Maybe I should have waited until Jonathan Taylor fell in the 5th or the 6th round. So that's something that I'm going to have to consider going forward is, oh, man, should I have drafted Jonathan Taylor or not there? Yahoo's going to say fantastic value because it's in the 4th. And if he plays, the dude could be a 1st-round pick. But that's why I also went back and nabbed James Conner and Rashad White, just in case of that happening, which was if Jonathan Taylor, in worst case scenario, is just not going to play this year, at least I got the running back depth to support that. So I feel very good about that. And then I still was able to get Mike Williams as my number two wide receiver. Keenan Allen gets hurt. And even if Keenan Allen doesn't get hurt, Mike Williams is in a better offense this year with Kellen Moore as the offensive coordinator. And he's the number two in one of the best offenses in the league. And in my opinion, having the second wide receiver in a really good offense is better than having a number one in a really bad offense. To each his own, though. And I feel like I got really good wide receiver depth after that. And I got the Cowboys in the 13th round defense. Excited about that. And they let me still get Kincaid on my bench, who, in my opinion, is going to be a big sleeper this year. So hopefully I can trade that man or something. That would be really cool. But yeah, so with my draft, I'm going to give myself an A-. Even though the Jonathan Taylor pick was there where it was made, I still was able to get running back depth where I wanted to and still draft the wide receiver tiers exactly where I wanted them to. There's certain guys that I was okay with not getting. Michael Pittman, Mike Evans, Jerry Jeudy, Drake London, take them. All these guys have a lot of question marks on their teams, but Mike Williams, Jordan Addison, Brandon Cooks, Cortland Sutton. All these guys are in prime offenses, maybe not Cortland Sutton, but he's the number one now. But everyone else is a wide receiver too. So I'm feeling good about that depth, and I'm hoping that one of these guys breaks out this year. That would be really fantastic. Okay, so now let's go ahead and jump to the sixth pick. We got Simmer. So with Simmer's team, we're going to talk about this team real quick. Tyreek Hill, Derrick Henry, Chris Olave, Mark Andrews in the fourth. Wow, that is fantastic value. Then he gets Keenan Allen. If Keenan Allen is healthy, Keenan Allen in the fifth round, damn, that's a steal. And then he gets Madison, sniped me in the sixth round. I was hurt about that. Lance Brandon Ayuk. Then he gets James Cook, who's going to be a three-down back. Jahan Dotson, probably a sleeper. Khalil Herbert, who looks like the starter, gets his quarterbacks. I don't know how I feel about either one of them, but hey, he's got two of them, so he can stream them throughout the year, so he'll figure that out. This guy's team is deep, and he did a great job drafting his team. So Simmer, I'm going to actually give you an A, bro. You actually have the best draft grade out of all of us. Your team is deep. You have running backs that are going to be three down backs. You have wide receivers that are going to be targeted. You got Mark Andrews who's only going to get targeted more. The only real question is your quarterback's going to show up. But you got Anthony Richardson who looks like mobility is going to be there. Tua, if he's healthy, he's great. So Simmer's team is going to be a very, very good team to watch because he's got a very deep bench to support his flex, his wide receivers, and his running back. So, Simmer, you're going to get an A. Let's go ahead and talk about Swag now at the seventh pick. Now, Swag drafted Cooper Kupp, and then A.J. Brown got the dual wide receiver hero. Now, obviously, this draft happened before Cooper Kupp has the hamstring injury. Now, Cooper Kupp looked like he's going to sit out week one, which means I'm probably going to get a dub. Let's go. No, I'm just kidding. But Cooper Kupp, with that situation, it was a great pick if he was healthy, right? Now, obviously, it's easy to say, oh, he shouldn't have drafted Cooper Kupp. He should have let him pass. But at that time, it was a good pick. Got Najee Harris in the third round. I think he wasn't happy with it, but you still got running back one for you in the third round. So that's still good to solidify. It's based on the tiers of positions that are available and the scarcity of each position. You got your running back, right? So that's a good pick. Got Lamar. So if you think Lamar is good this year, then that's great value. Lamar Jackson in the fourth round, going in fourth and third rounds in a lot of drafts. And then you got Kenneth Walker. That's what it's going to come down to is Kenneth Walker and Najee Harris going to be good this year? If they're good, your team is ready to go. You got your tight end. You got your wide receivers. Obviously, Cooper Kupp. We're going to talk about him in a second. Then you got DeAndre Hopkins. You got Chris Godwin, Michael Thomas. Chris Godwin's probably going to be very good this year. Hopkins has no reason to not be good unless the Titans really suck. David Njoku, I don't know how I feel about him. But Swag has good depth on his team. He has a lot of value on his team. But he just has some question marks that he might need to fill out. Like, is Kenneth Walker going to be that guy? Is David Njoku going to be that guy? Raheem Mostert, steal of the draft for him, though. All the way in round 12, gets RB1 for the Miami Dolphins. So he has a pretty good bench. Rashad Penny, that was a bit of a reach. I don't know how I feel about that. But your receivers is really what is the benefit of your team right now. If your running backs live up to their potential, Sway could be a dominant force in this league. But the problem is now is Cooper Kupp is obviously dealing with that injury. So Swag, it's going to be tough. But I'm going to base my draft grade before the Cooper Kupp injury because obviously no one knew that happened. We knew something was lingering, but it getting re-aggravated the way it did was not something that we anticipated right away. So I'm going to give Swag a B+. You have great depth. It just comes down to if Kenneth Walker is good and you're not needing to rely on Rashad Penny, then you're solid. But you still got Raheem Mostert on your bench, and your receivers are still pretty damn good anyway. Even if Cooper Kupp doesn't play, you still got guys that you can plug in right away. Swag might need to make a trade or two if Cooper Kupp puts him in a position like that this season. But other than that, I think you still did a good job drafting good depth in the ranges as well, too, that what you did. Let's go ahead and talk about pick number 8 now. We got Arnold on here. Arnold, fantastic. First 4 picks, like, Jesus. Saquon, Garrett Wilson, Calvin with the Aaron Jones. Now, he obviously reached a bit on Garrett Wilson. So, if Garrett Wilson does not finish better than A.J. Brown, Amon Ross, St. Brown, Devontae Adams, it's a reach then. But if he does, which he has very much potential to finish better than all these guys, then damn, that's great value right there of recognizing Garrett Wilson basically being a first-round talent next year and basically going in that range next year. Nabs up Calvin Ridley might have been a reach, but that's kind of the area of which Calvin Ridley starts to go in a lot of drafts. So he nabs up his dual wide receiver hero with his star running back. Is Saquon going to be healthy this year? I was a Saquon fantasy owner once, so we never know. You got to hope for the best with that. And if he is, then we're raw. Damian Pierce, it's so interesting because I look at Damian Pierce and I think of him as almost like a Stavon Ridley. He's way more talented than Stavon Ridley. But Stavon Ridley was raw his rookie season. And then I thought it was going to carry over to his second season, and it didn't. So I'm hoping Damian Pierce can get through that sophomore slump, but it looks like he can. The dude is running really hard and really efficient. It looks like he's the 3-down back in Houston. So that's a pick I've been very critical of. I don't know how I feel about him being a flex, but I very much could be wrong about that as well, too, because there's a lot of things that I'm wrong about in fantasy. So Damian Pierce is going to be a very big one where if that guy lives up to his potential, Arnold's team looks really good. But if he doesn't, if he struggles, maybe because Houston's O-line has been struggling, I think some guys got hurt, and maybe he has some really tough matchups, that's just going to put a cap on Arnold's team as far as how much they can actually go. Deshaun Watson, man, I have no idea how to feel about that one. I will say drafting him in the 6th round, he probably was still going to be there in the 8th or 7th round. That much I can say. Because if you look at the board, only one more team needed a quarterback before Arnold made that pick. And that one team took Anthony Richardson and Tua in the 11th and 13th round. So that tells you that they were not even trying to eye a quarterback before round 8, before round 9. So Deshaun Watson, he probably could have got him in the 10th round, in the 11th round, maybe. So who knows? Or maybe not. You never know, right? Jerry Jeudy, big question marks there. In my opinion, Cortland Sutton is about to be breakout player of the year. He's going to be last year's Josh Jacobs as far as like where he's being drafted and what's going to happen because Tim Patrick gone. There's another receiver that got hurt or whatever, right? And now you got Jerry Jeudy, who's dealing with injuries. It's just him and Marvin Mims, and Marvin Mims is a rookie. So Cortland Sutton, in my opinion, is going to boom. Jerry Jeudy is kind of in that same boat with Cooper Kupp where we really don't know. And it's so much like question marks with hamstrings and injuries. I don't want to touch that with a 10-foot pole. So that's questionable because now you basically got him and Pierce as your flexes. Damian Pierce is obviously a little bit more sure in that scenario. Kyle Pitts, great value actually in the 8th round. Kyle Pitts can live up to anything he can. That's a steal, in my opinion, because all these tight ends are going in the 6th round. David Njoku was taken in the 7th round over Kyle Pitts. So in my opinion, that was actually a great pick right there. But you also do have to look at the board. Yeah, I don't know, that's a good pick because Evan Ingram and Pat Fryer would get taken on later on. So you know that these GMs would have taken a tight end as well too. Not sure if I'm a fan of Marquise Brown. Jamal Williams only good for 3 games. So the bench is where it gets a little more questionable. Only Jerick McKinnon, in my opinion, provides actual depth on this guy's bench for PPR sake because he'll catch the ball. But his starters are really good. And if Damian Pierce lives up to the hype, if Kyle Pitts can live up to the name, then Arnold can have a pretty good year this year. But we're hoping for a lot of ifs, in my opinion. But with that being said, Arnold, I'm going to give you a B draft grade. That's right, a B. Because if Damian Pierce lives up to that hype, like I said, this team can be very good. But you got to hope a lot of these guys are going to be healthy. And a lot of these guys are going to be ready to run. Between Saquon, Jeudy, I mean, I don't know. That's a lot. So we'll see. But hey, we'll see what happens. All right, so now let's talk about pick number 9. My boy AT, Adrian. All right, you got Stephon Diggs, Nick Chubb. Then you got Josh Allen. Got the stack with Stephon Diggs. Then he went and got George Kittle, Miles Sanders, Drake London, Isaiah Pacheco, Christian Kirk. I mean, he was just going bang, bang, bang for pick for every pick. The only pick I'm just not a fan of the most is George Kittle. I'm already hearing he might not be playing week 1. So just based on where we're drafting some of these guys can hurt. But we never know. If Kittle is playing, Brock Purdy is going to throw him that ball. Unlike Jimmy G, unlike Trey Lance, unlike plenty of these other quarterbacks that for some reason just struggle to get him the ball. No, Brock Purdy will get him the ball. So if George Kittle, kind of like that Damian Pierce pick we were talking about, if he lives up to that hype, this is a damn good team. But Miles Sanders is an RB2. That's where it gets a little bit questionable. But Miles Sanders' role and the money he's getting paid says that he is of that value. We just got to see Miles Sanders live up to it. So with that being said, AT, I'm actually going to give you an A-. You have depth across the board. T. Higgins, Stephon Diggs with Drake London and Christian Kirk supporting that. What a receiving core. You have two running backs that are running back ones. And then you have guys that can support them that are fantastic for PPR. Isaiah Pacheco, Antonio Gibson. These guys are really good streaming values, and Isaiah Pacheco might boom off this year. So shout out to you. Kadarius Toney, Thielen, I don't know how good about those, but that's just bench plays at the end of the day. Or at least, like, you know, the late picks. You never know. Kadarius Toney could break out this year. Thielen, I don't know, that boy old as hell. So now let's talk about the 10th pick, the last one. Mike with the 10th pick in the draft. Obviously, this is the best one. I think a lot of you guys may have been waiting for this one if you're still watching this video. This one is great. And that's why we made it. I did it in the straight order of what it was. I want to talk about this one last. He had a very good two rounds. Okay, so Bijan Robinson, CeeDee Lamb gets his running back hero, gets his wide receiver one as well too. Then the board goes across. We get these picks flying. Jalen Hurts is going. Chris Olave, Najee Harris, Calvin Ridley, Josh Allen, Darren Waller. What? I still don't. What? So basically, what you're saying, Mike, is that Darren Waller is going to be tight end two this year. If he doesn't finish anything less than right behind Travis Kelce, this is the biggest reach in our fantasy football league history, actually. In my opinion, one of the biggest reaches in our league history, without a doubt. You're saying he's going to be better than Mark Andrews, TJ Hockenson, Dallas Goedert, George Kittle, Kyle Pitts, which some of those guys, a lot of people are going to say yeah, he is going to be better fantasy-wise. But Kittle gets taken two rounds later. Hockenson gets taken two rounds later. Andrews gets taken one round later. We talk about Darren Waller getting taken. He takes Devontae Smith after that. Here's who gets taken next. T. Higgins, Aaron Jones, Lamar Jackson. Mark Andrews then in the fourth round gets taken. Mark Andrews in the fourth round. Then Jonathan Taylor, Stevenson, Metcalf, Burrow, Hall, Herbert, Amari Cooper, Deebo Samuel, T.J. Hockenson in the fifth round in the fourth pick spot to just kneel right there. And then the next tight end doesn't go until when? Fifth round, George Kittle. That is crazy. Now, we could argue that he thinks that Darren Waller is going to be gone by the time he does his fourth pick, and that when it comes back to him at five, Darren Waller is not going to be there. But I don't know if Darren Waller was going to be taken there. I honestly think he probably still would have been on the board, and he probably could have nabbed Trevor Lawrence and Darren Waller and still got another guy. Just Neil and Mike, I don't know if just Neil's watching this part or not, but this is kind of what I mean by the Mahomes thing. You're basically passing up on so much value by saying that this guy is worth that spot. Now, Mahomes might finish as QB1. He's done it many times, obviously. But your RB2, Ramondre Stevenson, might not finish where Tony Pollard and Josh Jacobs are going to finish. And that difference in gap in fantasy points, in my opinion, can be very league-winning. So, if Darren Waller goes off this year, that is a great pick. But if he is not anything behind at least Travis Kelce, then that is the absolute biggest reach of this draft. So, Mike, your draft grade is a B+. I think your bench is fantastic. Christian Watson, Gabe Davis, Dalvin Cook, David Montgomery, Brian Robinson. You knew what you were doing in those later rounds to make up for that aspect. So I'll give you that much credit, is that if you're going to reach on somebody similar to just Neil, you got to make up for that depth later on in the draft. And you guys both did that as well. So, Mike, you're going to get a B+, man. So hope you guys enjoyed this video, just giving you guys your draft grades. Appreciate y'all, man. We're going to be dropping week 1 predictions as well soon, and the vlog, man. So y'all know what it is, baby. Till next time.